Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to this week's forum. We have a fantastic topic and an incredible panel to discuss it. So the topic today is it safe yet? Or could Wall Street still blow up the economy? I don't write these topics. And to discuss the topic today, we have three people who are incredibly knowledgeable about finance, Wall Street, and the recent financial crisis. First is somebody who is probably familiar to everybody in this room, Maria Bartiromo, who is the anchor and managing editor of Wall Street Journal Report on CNBC. She also anchors the Closing Bell program at the end of the market day. She's the author of The Weekend That Changed Wall Street, an eyewitness account, which is about the collapse of Lehman Brothers back in September 2008. She holds degrees in economics and journalism from NYU. She is also a trustee of the university. To my left is Joe Nocera, who is with us today from the New York Times, where he writes a business column and contributes to the magazine. He's also the co-author of a new book. I actually have a copy of this one. All the Devils Are Hidden, The Hidden History of...
No, All the Devils Are Here.
Are Here, rather, The Hidden History of the Financial Crisis, which is actually an incredibly good read. And also with us is Professor Roy Smith, who holds the Langone Chair in International Business and Finance just down the street at the Stern School of Business. His scholarship focuses on banking, mergers and acquisitions, the capital markets, and their role in investment and wealth creation. Before joining the world of academia, he was a key player in the world of banking. He was a senior partner at Goldman Sachs, where he worked for more than 20 years. So I'd like to turn the floor over first to Maria Bartiromo.
Thank you very much. Great to see you all. I guess for an opening, sort of set the stage for you type of intro, I would say that today, 2 years after the financial crisis, things feel much better. Part of the reason is the ability of the corporate sector to really streamline balance sheets. I think we would all agree on the panel, the financial crisis had much to do with leverage and the debt spiraling out of control when there were runs on the banks, and of course the connectedness of our global system. Not necessarily too big to fail, but too connected to fail is the way I would characterize what went on. I think 2 years later, we've seen a new regulatory environment, which I know we'll get into. We've seen an enormous amount of capital raises from the banks. And the corporate sector today is probably the healthiest we've seen in a very long time, with some $2.5 trillion in cash on corporate balance sheets, with the international economy having become much more important to American companies. Increasingly, you're seeing American multinationals derive more and more revenue from places like China, India, Brazil. There's an enormous amount of money moving into those economies right now. And while these corporates are sitting on all of that cash and not really putting it to work in the U.S., they are putting it to work on international economies. And I think that's one of the reasons we've seen better than expected earnings for several quarters now from the corporate sector. And I think one of the lessons and sort of changes we've seen since the financial crisis is an acknowledgement of debt and a change in behavior, not only on the corporate side of things, but on an individual side of things as well, because you've got individuals now saving more money, hoarding cash, the savings rate back up to 5% or so, being much more aware of debt because they have seen what leverage did to the global economy. I know we're going to talk about how the regulatory environment changed things and whether or not we are looking at the implementation of the rulemaking a little tougher than people thought, so we'll get into that. But I think overall, today you've got the U.S. economy sort of chugging along, managers unwilling to add significant numbers of heads to the payroll because they are concerned about the regulatory environment, how the business looks, a lack of clarity, as well as higher expenses. But the international story, quite vibrant in some parts of the world. So I know we'll get into all of that. I send it back to you. Thank you.
Joe Nocera.
Thank you. The title of the panel is it safe yet? And the answer is no. It's safe for the moment. And I think about this in two different ways. One is that I have written a bunch in my column about the psychology of bubbles. And one of the things that I have sort of come to believe is that despite terms like collateralized debt obligations and subprime mortgages and securitizations and so on and so forth, what really took place was not that different from Dutch tulips 400 years ago. The difference is that 400 years ago, an entire society believed that the price of tulips could only go up. And in our society, over the last 20 years, and especially in the last four or five in the run-up to the financial crisis, an entire society came to believe that housing prices could only go in one direction, and that was up. And that affected every level of financial society. It caused homeowners to buy homes that were larger than they could afford or take out cash-out refinancings on the theory that they'd never have to deal with the adjustable-rate mortgage because they could refinance because the price of the house would go up. It caused mortgage originators and mortgage brokers to lure people into loans that they couldn't ever pay back because they thought to themselves, well, the price of the house is going to go up and they can always refinance. It caused risk managers to... We had the CEO of MBIA in our office the other day. MBIA is a large bond insurance company that has basically been on the ropes the last few years. And somebody asked him in the meeting, were your risk models wrong? And he said, well, no, they weren't. Our risk models showed if the price of a house went down 20%, we'd be bankrupt. We just didn't believe it could ever happen. And of course, on Wall Street, the same psychology took hold in 100 different ways and helped create a pervasive madness that finally ended with the weekend of September, the weekend that Maria wrote about in her book. Bubbles are part of the human condition. Delusion is part of the human condition. It doesn't go away just because we're sophisticated and we use mathematical risk models and we think that we live in a more enlightened society and a more rational society than the Dutch 400 years ago. One of the things that happens, and I think this is what Roy's going to talk about a little bit, is when there is a crash, there is always a search for villains and there's an attempt... Everybody uses the mantra, we won't let this happen again. We're going to create laws and reforms that will prevent this from ever happening again. One of the things that's really impressive about the aftermath of the crash of 1929 is that they really did create a regulatory regime that was effective for three generations. Part of the reason that there was really no real crashes from 29 till 87, really. There wasn't much in the way of a market. There was a crash of 87, and then we went through this somewhat more volatile era. But you had two things happening. One is that our grandparents were so scarred by the Depression that greed was never going to overcome fear. Fear was going to be the reigning emotion of their lives. But even after... they were succeeded by other generations. You had the creation of the SEC, you had the erection of Glass-Steagall, and you had a series of other regulatory reforms that put in place a regulatory regime that made it difficult for crashes to take place because of the various strictures and the various barriers. And it wasn't until the 80s that these barriers started to come down when financial innovators and sort of clever people started to find loopholes and started to exploit those loopholes.
Joe, could you just explain what Glass-Steagall is?
Who doesn't know what Glass-Steagall is?
Well, don't embarrass people. Okay. Just explain it.
Okay. Sorry.
Sorry, Joe. No
more.
Sorry. Glass-Steagall is a law that forced the commercial banks to sheave off their investment banking divisions, and they created separate companies. Investment banking and commercial banking were, instead of being under one house, had to be under two roofs and were completely separated. And one of the things that did happen in the last 20 years is that they became melded again until finally in 1999, Glass-Steagall was once and for all abolished. So my point is not that there won't be other bubbles, but you know, the best case scenario is, will the next bubble be 60 or 70 years from now, or will the next bubble be 10 or 15 years? And on that note, I will stop.
Great. Thank you. Roy?
Well, I think I can say that Wall Street would like you to know that they don't intend to do it, but they haven't lost their capacity to blow up the markets again. They still have the clout and the power to do so. And remember that today, the market capitalization of all stocks and bonds in the world, which can travel across borders very quickly, is $150 trillion. Now, to a lot of people, that's a fair amount of money, and it can cause a lot of market changes by swashing from one place to another, which it will do because of bubbles or because of burstings of bubbles. So we haven't really addressed what are we going to do about all this floating capital that can slosh around very quickly in any of our regulatory efforts so far. Well, at least we haven't entirely dealt with it. I would like to make three basic points. One is that the last major banking crisis occurred in the 1980s. It was global. It involved all of the usual suspects, and it took 15 years to resolve, one consequence of which was that while the banks were under wraps by their regulators, the capital markets emerged as the principal source of corporate finance for pretty much everybody who had access to it, which is why we have $150 trillion of outstanding capital today. Another is that the world did its first ever effort to regulate the capital levels of banks so that they wouldn't have some with more than others, or we wouldn't have a competitive disadvantage from being allowed to take more leverage than the rest. So they committed something. The central banks of the leading countries got together in Basel, Switzerland. They formed a committee called the Basel Committee. The Basel Committee spent a year or so coming up with minimum risk-adjusted bank capital adequacy standards. These went into effect in 1992. They were called Basel I because there was a subsequent effort to reform them and to improve them, which never really got in place before the last crisis we've just been through occurred and this thing all blew up. We now are dealing with Basel III, which is an effort to get it right this time. I'll come back to that in a second. Now, the second point I want to make is that the current financial crisis was the second one in 10 years, following the tech wreck that started in 2000. It was the second one to have a major impact on the global economy, the real economy, that causes bankruptcies and people to be out of work and so on. So the second time in 10 years, or less than 10 years, was very concerning to people. Is this going to happen all the time now because we have all this capital market sloshing about? And there was a lot of anger and at those who caused it, and a lot of concerns about the willingness of the government to bail people out. So the Dodd-Frank bill was assembled in Congress was assembled by the angry and the concerned. And the whole idea was to bring an end to the idea that we have to bail people out, these undeserving banks that got paid too much. Why should they be bailed out? And, we want to make sure this doesn't happen again. Unfortunately, very few people in the Congress understood this stuff, and so we ended up with a really large enterprise to try to regulate it by shotgun approach. If you shoot enough shotgun shells at it, it ought to hit a few of the important things. And it did do that to some degree. But what they essentially said was that even though in the 1980s, after we had the bankruptcy of Continental Illinois, the seventh largest bank in the U.S., and the U.S. government then being driven by Paul Volcker at the Fed, decided that our policy for banks was to have a regulatory apparatus that contained them, but if we screwed it up, to have a safety net that would prevent the crisis from contaminating the whole financial system in the world and creating a Great Depression. So regulation failed, but then there was a safety net in case it didn't work. The basic idea of the Dodd-Frank bill is to turn that around. We're not going to have a safety net, okay? We are not going to bail people out. There are provisions in the bill that make it virtually impossible to bail out anybody who fails in the future, no matter how big, how connected, how whatever. Now, it's actually possible to squeak a little bit through if you say you're only doing something for liquidity purposes, but it's going to be a lot harder than it was. And therefore, the rest of the effort is to make sure it doesn't happen by making the remainder of the banking system fail-safe. Now, fail-safe, to be fail-safe, means it's pretty tightly boxed up. You don't have a lot of loose money around. You don't have a lot of risk gets out of control and so on. But they didn't really address how that was to be done in the statute. They did say that the existing regulatory system would essentially be the same, except that we added a new layer of people to have a meeting about it. And in the end, there have to be about 250 new regulations drafted by the existing regulators in the context of to try to make all the things that are brought out in Dodd-Frank come about. Now, this is a real dog's breakfast way of making a piece of regulation, and you wouldn't expect much of it. So the question is it going to do any good? It essentially does two things. It identifies the systemically important banks and non-banks. They haven't yet identified the systemically important non-banks. They're supposed to do that. I mean, they've had a couple of years, but they still haven't done it. You know who you are. And those identified systemically important banks or non-banks will be required to have enhanced regulatory standards. They haven't said what enhanced means yet, but it probably means more of whatever it was that's in the regulatory apparatus in the first place, which is largely going to depend, as it did before, on the capital minimum risk-adjusted capital adequacy standards that are now coming out of Basel III. These have been released. We know what they are. They are going to be draconian compared to Basel I. So people who have a Tier 1 capital of 14% will, in fact, have about 7% under Basel III.
And Roy, what does Tier 1 capital mean?
Well, the Basel capital system divides bank capital into two parts, Tier 1, which is equity capital, and Tier 2 is other stuff like reserves and subordinate debt and so on. Tier 1 is what counts. It used to be only 4%. Now it's going to end up being 7.5% or so, and the standards by which you get to count it are going to be really tightened up. So this is going to be a meaningful increase in the capital adequacy standards. You're going to have a lot more capital than you have had before, and probably a lot more than you want, because it won't all be needed every day. So the big part of this is that we're going to rely on Basel plus whatever enhancements, and we're going to rely on something called the Volcker rules. This is named after Paul Volcker, who said that he thought banks ought to go back to being banks and not try to be fancy investment banks, as they did when Glass-Steagall was repealed in 99. And because when they tried to be investment banks, which we outlawed in the 30s, but we let happen again later on, the trouble is that they take on all these risks that they don't really understand very much about. And our other speakers' books will all speak to this point. They didn't know about these risks in all cases. So the Volcker rule, when it was first announced, was sort of poo-pooed. Larry Summers really wasn't for it, and the industry said, no, we don't do much proprietary trading, and anyway, it had nothing to do with the crisis, so don't regulate the wrong thing, and it got very little traction for a while. But it did end up in the bill, and it simply said there cannot do proprietary trading, although that had to be defined, and it wasn't easy to do because it's complex. And they said they would, don't worry, we're going to write some new rules later on. We'll tell you what they are. Last week, the Financial Stability Oversight Council, which is this new supervising board on top of all the other regulators, came out with a report on what these proprietary trading rules are likely to be. And it was an 80-page report with a lot of stuff to go through. But they actually suggested in there that they knew what was going on. they were smarter about this than we might have thought. And my reading of it is that they are going to essentially aggregate trading inventories and separate them by asset class, type of strategies, and by maturities, and essentially define them to say you can do anything you want as a market maker, but if it exceeds these limits, you can't do it. So that's going to reduce trading for these firms, which among the top 10 firms, which have 80% of the market, they range from 25 to 80% of revenues coming from trading. So trading is going to be less active, and in that trading is going to be less risk. So, you know, the Volcker rule in the end may get the last laugh because it's going to have more teeth in there than, in, you know, the rules themselves won't be out until June, but you heard it here. They may have to do it. Now, how is this going to affect the banks? The real question here is, will the banks change their business models, which depended upon being very large, having big balance sheet strategies that could dominate situations with clients and be flow traders to see all the flows from all over the world to be able to insert their own stuff into these tradings? Will they continue to be able to do that? And if they do, then Dodd-Frank won't make much difference. And Basel III may not make much difference either. There'll still be trillion-dollar banks out there, not smaller than they were, so they will still be too big to fail, but if there's no safety net, they'll just fail and kill us all. Now, they won't let that happen, so you know, either they have to be broken up or made less risky. And this is, the question is, will they respond to this regulation that way? And a lot of people don't think they will. But there is another hope. Right now, the big banks, the 10 big banks, are all trading below book value on average. Couple are a little bit above book value, but most are trading, on average, below book value, with a price-earnings ratio of half the S&P 500 average price-earnings ratio. They have a return on investment of around 8% on average, with the highest one being 11.5%, and the average cost of capital of these banks, these 10 banks, is about 11%. Now, let me tell you something. You may not learn at the law school, but if you're in business and you have a return on equity of 7% and a cost of capital of 11%, you've got a bad business model. This is not going to work. And that's why their stocks are trading poorly. So the market is expecting these business models to be changed, to be essentially put into smaller, more manageable units in which the high cost of capital of being a systematically important firm will be dealt with by sending the riskier parts of that, spinning it off, and sending it somewhere else. So this is going to have to happen in the next few years, and we will know whether we've made any improvement in the regulatory situation by whether or not these banks break themselves into smaller and more manageable and more risk-controllable units than they have been before. I'm sorry it takes so long. I am a finance professor, and you know, I have to get this off my chest. So. I will turn it back over to our moderator. Well, with my apologies.
I'm sympathetic. So I think we can move directly to questions from the floor. We have a couple microphones that will go around. So please raise your hand and keep it raised until a microphone gets to you. We have somebody back here in the middle. And when you please stand. And when you stand, please identify yourself, if you're a law student, what year you are, and then your question.
Hi, I'm Diana Whitaker, and I'm a third-year law student. And this question is kind of more economics-related, not necessarily legal. But in his recent investment outlook letter, Bill Gross of PIMCO said that Chairman Bernanke's zero-interest rate policy today will impose a devil's haircut on bondholders through depreciated currency. What would happen if the price of commodities skyrocket and the Treasury afford to pay 18% interest on the national debt as it had done under Volcker in the 80s? I also want to ask if the Federal Reserve has power to bail out local and state governments.
Okay. So two questions. I don't think the microphone was working. The first question was, what would happen if interest rates spiked to what they were in the late 70s, early 80s, 15, 16, 17, 18%? And the second question is about bailouts of state and local governments, how that might, well, can you just sort of identify just a little more what that second part of your question is about?
Well, Meredith Whitney recently became popular enough municipal debt, and she's anticipating that a lot of states will be
Okay, so the question is, what can regulators do if there is a wave of municipal and perhaps even state defaults on debt? Anyone on the panel want to take one or both of those on?
Well, I can tell you that the municipals are sovereign entities, and they are not covered under our Constitution as things that belong to the federal government. So there are real issues as to whether they can or should be bailed out, and there is no statutory power really to do it, or even to go bankrupt. If they, you know, bankruptcy is a legal concept. For sovereigns, there is no bankruptcy. They just don't pay, and too bad. You have to figure out some way to get it back from them. So the recent articles about states going bankrupt are pretty unlikely to happen, but there may be exchange offers or some kind of way to reduce debt by, you know, having some haircuts taken by existing debt holders. So, you know, Meredith Whitney has forecasted a very large amount of municipal defaults, which all the municipal experts disagree with, by the way.
Yeah, I mean, I would add to that that the other day I was walking in New York and there was so much garbage everywhere, and it really felt like tough times. And I was walking with a friend and I thought to myself, you know, they haven't picked the garbage up in X number of weeks, and you know, the snow is piling up, and I feel like this is what it feels like when faced with deficits. And I think, you know, you could compare the states of America to what's happening a bit in Europe, where the Eurozone is facing its own issues because of debt and budget deficits. And, you know, it's a similar, obviously it's not apples to apples, but it's a similar story because the states don't have an ability to issue currencies. You know, they've got one currency, they've got one central bank, and that's really what's happening in the Eurozone as well. I don't think that the federal government will allow a state to go bankrupt and we see defaults. Meredith Whitney's report was very aggressive. She did face a lot of pushback from people like the Labenthals, obviously people on the state level. So I suspect that we are looking at very serious situations in terms of deficits on the state and municipality level, but that we'll see ramifications on the ground. Services will be cut. Union contracts will have to be redone. But as far as defaults and an actual, you know, bankruptcy on a state level, I would say it's unlikely. It doesn't mean it's going to be easy.
So just a quick point in response to the second part of your question. Municipal governments can file under the bankruptcy code. There's a chapter of the bankruptcy code that's designed for municipalities. There are more restrictions on getting into a municipal bankruptcy than on, say, a Chapter 11 for a business. States, on the other hand, aren't covered under Chapter 9. And it seems very unlikely that a state could be forced into bankruptcy. A state would have to consent. There'd have to be some statutory authority, and who knows if Congress would ever do that. So it may be something that ends up happening, but I'm not sure if that's likely. Let's take a question from right here up front.
Hi, I'm Eric Uhlfelder from the Financial Times, and if I could just follow up on the haircuts that would happen on municipal or state governments. If that happens, interest rates on any future loans would just go up and you would further exaggerate the problem. So I don't think that would probably help us out of the situation. It probably would make it worse, and just wanted to share hear your thoughts on that to see if there is an alternative towards haircuts.
Well, it depends who's taking the haircuts. And there are two ways. You can look at the bondholders of these states, may be told, look, things could get worse here. Your bonds are trading at 92. They aren't all that bad. We will exchange them for new bonds worth 91, but they are going to be long-term bonds, which will have a different cash flow effect and give the state some breathing room or something like that. But because you're not going to be able to reduce the debt very much, because it's not trading at 70 or something, it really isn't necessarily going to be the way out for the states. The states are better off if they could go to their unfunded pension obligations and to their health care obligations and to their employment contracts and try to work out restructuring through exchange arrangements with them. And say, you know, for example, all you guys on the pension fund, we want to make you a voluntary exchange offer to give you a 401k. You're going to take a haircut, but you're going to get something better than what you had before. Now, maybe that'll work, maybe it won't work, but in Utah, they just put all the new people coming into the state pension fund on a 401k. So if you can start to parcel them off, you reduce these deficits, that takes away some of the pressure on the sovereign credit of these various states and so forth.
Or the sovereign
are in worse shape than others, that's for sure.
Or the sovereign could raise taxes.
Well, they could always raise taxes if they want to, if the state legislature will do so. And most of the reason why they don't go bankrupt at the end is because they do raise the taxes as opposed to fail. But in the meantime, the reason you don't see the state bonds trading at a really big discount is because people don't expect the states to fail. And a lot of them are trading at pretty good interest rates. So on a tax-sheltered basis, they are attractive relative to treasuries. But I think you're going to see the real effort by the states, or the things like are going on in New Jersey with Governor Christie trying to exchange labor agreements for some other labor agreement that gives more relief and involves some sharing of the haircut.
I mean, all of the above is likely to happen, whether it's, you know, new agreements with unions, cutting of services, higher taxes. And I think you make the right point because the market is telling you what's coming. You look what's happening in the muni bond market right now, and interest rates have, in fact, gone up. And so ultimately, people are worried about the inflationary impact of all of this and rates moving higher.
Let's take a question from right up front, right here. And if you could speak into the microphone.
Hi, I'm Alex. I'm a 2L. I have a question about inflation. It hasn't shown up in CPI numbers in the US, but there are some that have questioned those statistics and say that there is more inflation in the US and around the world, in China, in Brazil, in Egypt, Tunisia, you do see inflation. I'm wondering to what extent you think that that's a result of government stimulus and things like QE2 versus how much of it is a result of just commodity price inflation due to increased demand? And going into the future, if we do see inflation, will that be a monetary phenomenon or will that be a result of higher demand for commodities and higher demand in general?
Okay. He's looking for investment advice, anyway.
I think it's both. I think what you're seeing on the one hand is real demand coming out of places like China and India as those populations grow. And that has impacted the prices of all sorts of commodities, whether it's copper or iron ore or steel or soft commodities like food, agriculture. So I think on that score, you do have real price increases outside of the, because of demand outside of the U.S. impacting prices of commodities. And then you've got QE2, which has, I think, added to it. And we're importing inflation because of what's happening in China. Housing prices up 7-8% every month. And we are, in some sense, importing it. But there's also a deflationary story going on because the economy in the U.S. is still slow moving. And in Europe, it's also very much a mixed situation where you've got countries like the Nordic countries in Germany doing well, but the South still deflationary and weak. I'm just back from Davos. I was astounded at how many people at the World Economic Forum were actually worried about inflation. I didn't think it was as much an issue because we're sort of bumping along the bottom in the U.S., but that concern is definitely heightening because of everything just mentioned, commodities and QE2.
I want to sort of jump in here because the questions so far have sort of been about what's the next big thing that might put us into a tailspin. Sovereign defaults, municipal bond defaults, spike in inflation, commodity prices going crazy. But that sort of leads to a more basic question that I don't think we've addressed directly, which is, was the financial crisis preventable? Because, you know, it might be the case, as Joe said, that there always will be crisis to crisis to crisis, and it all depends on whether or not some bump in the road turns into a real disaster. That's the question. We'll never get rid of potential downturns or potential bumps in the road, but the question is, can we contain them and prevent them from going haywire? Last week, the Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission came out with its report, and the dissenting members of the commission wrote a sort of a response that suggested that at the end of the day, the financial crisis wasn't really foreseeable or preventable. And if that's the case, if that's true, then maybe we really shouldn't be having this panel at all because there's nothing that could have been done about the financial crisis and there's nothing that can be done to prevent the next bump in the road that suddenly blows up
into a huge financial crisis. Any comments on that thought?
A lot of people, the majority in the FCIC report was basically trying to say a lot of bad actions took place. I think that's unarguable. And it is also true, at least in my own reporting about it, that there were a significant number of naysayers, or people saying there's a problem here, who were not listened to. And one of the reasons they were bad, I mean, so for, to cite perhaps the most glaring example, Alan Greenspan had two jobs, one of which he cared deeply about, which was monetary policy, and one of which he cared not at all about, which is regulatory oversight over the systemic soundness of the banking system. And he acknowledged it in his memoirs that he doesn't care about regulation. And so people would come into his office and say, you know, well, Mr. Greenspan, do you have a subprime mortgage? And he'd say, of course not. I hate uncertainty. And time and time again, not just him, but regulators were warned that what was going on Main Street was unsustainable, it was a problem. It wasn't just that predatory lending was going on, although there was more of that going on than was generally acknowledged at the time. It was that large numbers of people were getting loans they could never pay back. Whether that's predatory or not, it's a problem. And yet, because of the, because so many people have been caught up in the bubble or sort of unwilling to step outside of their belief system or their bubble mentality, they were unwilling to look at that problem square in the face. So, you know, if certain people in certain institutions had been more rigorous, smarter, tougher, look, if Merrill Lynch had been as smart as Goldman Sachs, they'd still exist. If Lehman Brothers had had a decent risk system, you know, they wouldn't have gone under. You know, on and on and on you can go. So you can say everybody got caught up on it, and that is true. But it's also true that on an individual level, lots of people took actions or didn't take actions that were required that could have, at a minimum, saved their own firm, if not necessarily the society at large.
I agree with that, and I think part of it was a mentality that you didn't want to lose the business. So, you know, even if somebody inside, and Joe, correct me if I'm wrong here, if you agree, even if somebody inside Merrill said, look, this doesn't feel right. You know, I mean, this market is at such levels, it doesn't feel sustainable. You know, well, if you're not going to take the business, that business is going to Wachovia. That business is going to...
And that is exactly what happened. People who said that got kicked out and were replaced by more aggressive people who were willing to toe the line.
So there was this competitive spirit going on that everybody wanted a seat at the table and kept taking on the business, even if you had your naysayers in there saying it didn't make sense, which, of course, is the nature of bubbles.
We did a lot of work at the Stern School on trying to trace the causes of this crisis, and we wrote a book. 40 faculty members, oddly enough, got together and agreed on writing a book about something and delivered it on time. It was the first time any herd of cats has ever been directed in such a way. We basically concluded that there were three factors. One is a very loose monetary policy that encouraged a bubble to form in the real estate sector around the world, not just in the U.S., Second, that there was a very lax regulatory apparatus holding the whole thing up. It was both out of date, because the last time we'd fixed it up again was in the 80s. It's since repealed Glass-Steagall, and all the things that Joe said were operating there. It wasn't that Alan Greenspan wasn't interested in regulation. He was interested very strongly in there not being regulation. So he was a proactively deregulation fellow, and you know, he would point out there are a lot of benefits from that in terms of lowering cost of capital, innovation, and all this other stuff. And the third reason is because the banks turbocharged the whole process like the bejesus. And we all know that happens, and anybody who thinks a bunch of these banks are not essentially economic animals doing what economic animals do would be looking at it the wrong way. But what is it going to be? You know, the question is, have we changed the regulatory, you know, controls or backstops or limits on the system so that we don't get into another one when another bubble comes along, as inevitably it will, as Joe has said. And that really is going to be a question of whether anything really changes. Now, if we're going to keep gigantic banks who have average balance sheets of over $1 trillion, you know, there are at least 30 of these around in the world, still trading actively in securities in which their inventory turnover may be, have a day's life or something, then we are asking for trouble, because risk will change and risk management is difficult. And there were 300,000 people working at Citigroup. How closely controlled was risk management likely to be at a place like that? So the only way I think we can see so far is whether the industry decides to restructure itself because its business model is broken. I said that before, but I think that in the end is going to be the test of whether we've changed anything or whether we haven't. And if we haven't changed things, we're in a lot more trouble because we have made it much more difficult for anybody to get bailed out, which means that when they hit the mountain, it's going to have a pretty explosive impact in the future, just as it did before.
I'm going to have trouble sleeping tonight. Let's take any questions over here? We haven't taken one from all the way over there.
Hi, my name's Chad. I'm a second-year law student, and I believe I heard the professor touch on this previously, but why should we not be concerned about too big to fail? I mean, I think that's what you were alluding to when you said gigantic banks, gigantic balance sheets. But now we have fewer banks with bigger balance sheets, you know, and just more concentration generally. So, I mean, isn't there still that huge risk that if one of them makes a bunch of bad decisions, all those people who are out there crying in the wilderness saying this is a bad idea get fired, and one of those goes under? Why is that not going to re-trigger a whole other financial crisis?
Well, it might. I mean, that's what I thought I was saying, is that the too big to fail banks remain, except they're not too big to fail anymore in the sense that they have some sort of implicit government guarantee. The cost of financing.
Well, wait. Your reading of Dodd-Frank, which I'm sure is closer than, and I know it's closer than mine, is that they have made it more difficult to bail out even a too-big-to-fail bank.
Any bank.
So what he's asking, and it's a really interesting question, is if one of those big banks, you know, whose profits are coming at least in part these days because they're winding down their reserve, they're taking reserve capital and putting it in the profit and loss statement, in the P&L, if it turns out another shoe drops and one of those big banks gets in trouble again, would the government or wouldn't the government feel a need to bail it out?
I think it would, but it'd be constrained by this law.
So then what happens?
Well, that's a good question. Now, if you cannot bail it out, plus there's the fact that to what extent is the market going to anticipate this problem, and once it sees any problem with any large bank sometime in the future, be just the first indication of it, how do you know that at that point they won't withdraw money from every bank? They'll simply say, this is an area that's too risky to be in because there's nobody going to assure me that they will be bailed out. So, you know, it means I take my money out of all the tap-type banks, whether I take it out in deposits or maybe I don't do that because retail people don't know that so much, but the institutional market takes it out. They don't roll over commercial paper. They don't roll over the tradable CEs. The next thing you know, these guys have a liquidity crisis, just like Continental Illinois had. All of a sudden, all the banks are subject to this, because there's no assurance that the government will provide the safety net. That's a very dangerous thing that Dodd-Frank has done.
Well, now, Maria mentioned at the beginning, it's not just too big to fail, it's too connected to fail. So does Dodd-Frank contain any provisions that either force or encourage floodgates to come down and stop off?
Well, the powers
connectedness.
Yes, the regulators have some sort of power to create an orderly liquidation. But if I announce that I'm thinking about an orderly liquidation of Citigroup, what happens to its stock, bond prices, rollover ability, etc.? It goes to zero. And not only that, the same thing happens to all the others who seem to be in the same neighborhood. So that is not likely to be a very practical way to be able to address this problem, because as soon as they say they're thinking about it, and by the way, the statute requires all sorts of time delays and appeals in the courts and all that stuff before you get it done, come on, it's just not going to work. As soon as anybody mentions it, there's going to be an avalanche. So they won't mention it. So how are they going to stop this from happening? You know, they have, in order to be able to intervene, they have to actually have a declaration from the Financial Stability Oversight Council, which itself is a complexity. All this stuff is not going to be easy. It's going to have to come down to whether or not, A, the banks protect themselves from getting into this mess again. They did not enjoy this the last time. Some of you may think that they really did. They didn't like this. Most of them got creamed. But otherwise, the law is going to get weaseled around in some way. They're going to say, well, it says you can't do it, but we'll pass a tarp or something like that. Maybe that'll be the way it gets done in the end. But, you know, the trouble is these markets collapse first, and then they go out and pass tarp. You know, all this trouble happened really because Lehman Brothers was allowed to fail after Bear Stearns was not. And the market was completely wrong-footed, so everybody took all of their money out of every financial institution, money market fund, commercial paper, everything at once, leaving us with this complete vacuum of all sorts of liquidity for the market that lasted for another year.
Which is why all of this really is based on confidence. And the confidence of investors was shaken. And so we can have guardrails in place, which is, I think, what Dodd-Frank is attempting. But at the end of the day, it also comes to common sense and people overseeing businesses that those people understand what has become very complex instruments. And part of the issue in terms of government is, frankly, on a very basic level, the people who are understanding the complex derivatives are not looking to go work at a government job that they're not going to get paid. And so you don't have the sophisticated people overseeing some of these businesses in government to truly be effective. So I think we would all agree that, yeah, it can happen again. And it may not be the same shape. It may not be the same form. It may be a different reason. But free markets are messy, and it can happen again.
Let's take a question up front in the middle here.
I'm Jason, and I'm a 3L. I guess my question is for Maria and then Professor Smith. You mentioned at Davos last week, everyone was ultra concerned about inflation. And we all know there's an inflationary spiral, and it's the boogeyman in the closet. But for nearly 30 years now, the Federal Reserve in the United States has done a fantastic job controlling inflation. They've done an unbelievable job, in my opinion, over the last 2 or 3 years steering the world's economy. And in a lot of ways, we need to spur job growth in this country. And we've cut a lot of costs, and corporate profits are very healthy, but spurring the top line hasn't really been there. And by spurring inflation, which a lot of members of the Fed would like to do, and a lot of people think that is a great way to have a GDP for a year or two or three at 4%+, is a great way to get a self-sustaining economy as the Fed, or as the government cuts aid to the states and there's going to be a lot of pain on local levels. There's a lot of ways to spur growth that way. You don't want to let it get out of control. We don't want in Argentina, we don't want the United States under Jimmy Carter in the late 1970s, but why is everybody so, why is the fear of inflation so there, so much there, when major world economies, be it from Western Europe and the United States, hasn't really had the fear of inflation for nearly 30 years now?
Okay, so the question is, who is afraid of inflation and why?
Well, you know, I think I agree with you on the Fed. I think the Fed has done a great job. I think people worry about the spiraling of commodities prices, for one, and what's happening in China in terms of property prices. You know, I mean, when you look around the world and you see the population growth and you see the billion people joining the ranks of the middle class outside of the United States, you recognize that that really is the opportunity for American companies to actually show growth. The inflation story, I don't think, really has been an issue in the U.S. because of the slow moving situation in terms of the economy here and the persistent unemployment. So you really haven't seen that. Are we importing inflation from China because of high prices? By the way, inflation may have actually helped the issue on currency out of China because of the price rises in property and because of the price rises in commodities, things have become more expensive, which of course is one of the issues with the U.S. government on the cheap currency coming out of China. I think people are worried about inflation because of what they're seeing there in house prices and because of what they're seeing in commodities. Let's take oil for one. So we've got this massive unrest going on right now in Egypt and Tunisia and throughout the Middle East, and oil prices are now kissing up to $100 a barrel. You've got Brent North Sea above $100 a barrel right now. What happened the last time oil skyrocketed above 100? When you had oil at $147 a barrel, which of course was unsustainable, it choked economic growth a bit. And that's the worry, that you're seeing price hikes across the board in commodities, and that will create higher expenses for people and for corporates and choke off an economic recovery that is just really beginning to gain traction. I think the reason that I mentioned the international market earlier, and I continue to go back to it, is because it's going to be imperative for U.S. economic growth, which opens up the conversation to so many other issues, immigration, education, so many other issues in terms of enabling American companies to sell to some of these markets. President Hu's visit from China to the U.S., are those markets truly open to American businesses? You've got 300 million people in this country, 1.3 billion in China, 1.1 billion in India. At some point, American companies, in order to grow, need to see bigger markets. And so I think all of this stuff is related.
One reason people worry about inflation in this country is because we have a large deficit, you know, and which is in part a function of the economy that we're in and the fact that we went through a financial crisis. And so hence, and one of the ways you try and grow out of a deficit is you print money. I mean, it has happened in the past. And hence the Republican desire to, you know, cut spending and grapple with it, but that has its own risk because you know, that just inflicts further pain potentially and chokes off. So it's this constant sort of tricky balance. You know, Bernanke makes a decision that QE2 is non-inflationary and therefore it's worth the risk. I just would also like to remind you that in about 1936, the country thought it was out of the Depression. Economic growth was back. You know, manufacturing was back. And that year, Roosevelt thought the time had come to cut back on federal spending and to try and close that deficit. And the result was the country spiraled right back into the Depression and didn't really get out of it until we entered World War II. So there's a danger of inflation, yes, but there's also a danger that if you cut spending too much, there's a danger the other direction.
I mean, and I think you're seeing that across the world. You're seeing that across the world, this debate. Do we need stimulus to boost a slow economy? I mean, look at the UK. Or do we need to cut back spending so that we could actually get our arms around long-term issues? I think the QE2 is boosting the economy and the markets right now. Frankly, the markets have been up since July of last year in the US. We're talking double-digit percentage moves. Has anything materially really changed in the US? Still got close to 10% unemployment. Still got a pipeline of foreclosures in the pipeline that we're going to have to deal with this year. So what happens when QE2 and the buying of this $600 billion in securities ends, which is probably around April?
Let's take a question from all the way over there.
Actually, I have a comment. Can I do one of those too?
Question. Just a question.
Well, what I'd like to do, though, is I'd like to encourage everyone to please listen to the gentleman from the New York Times. He's got it exactly right.
No, no, no. If you don't, do you have a question? A question.
Let me say where I'm coming from. I was a trader and portfolio manager for 15 years on Wall Street. All right, so I have some idea of what's going on there. And the one thing that I would add to what he said is that Wall Street wasn't just an act. You know, we didn't see it coming. From Wall Street's point of view, from Wall Street's point of view, they know what he knows, that they know that there's been blues and busts, which you don't, because you're too young. If you're only in your 20s or your 30s, you haven't been through one of these yet. But even if you're in your 40s, you've been through the crash of 63, been through the crash of 87, you've been through the tech bubble in 2000, you've been through the biotech bubble, I think it was 2002. You know these things happen. But this is what Wall Street thinks. They think the way that people would do it in pyramid schemes. Let's try to make it simple.
Okay. I think we have to go back to questions from the floor. Let's take a question. No, let's take a question from back there, please. Right there.
Thank you. My name is John.
The problem with Wall Street is they don't listen to directions. Yes, please.
My name is John. I'm a third-year law student. I think that in the last few years, following the initial crash, there's a lot of lost, if we had any faith in the banking industry, they showed very little contrition for the, sort of the harm they caused the economy in general. They showed very little willingness to pay some bills. I think Steve Schwartzman said that raising his taxes would be like Nazis invading Poland. And recently reported that 2010 bank salaries were the highest they'd ever been in history. It's sort of two parts. I wonder if we should have any confidence in the banking industry, the people in it, would sort of take responsibility for their role in society and feel some degree to restrain themselves for the sort of the good of the country and the world at large. And if not, if any regulatory regime could be put in place that is going to be smarter or quicker than them to keep them from their sort of their inner demons from bringing us down again.
Okay. Great question.
You're a little harsh. People who gravitate to Wall Street are more compensation-oriented than, that's why you go to Wall Street. You
want to get a two-syllable word for that.
You want to get rich. I mean, it's not that, you know, we live in a society with many people who have many motives. People who want to get rich tend to go to Wall Street. So that's their mindset. It is absurd to say that they should control themselves. That's not how they work, how they think, how they act, how they are. It is up to the society to create appropriate incentives so that they don't maximize the short term for themselves with the long term harm for us. I mean, it really is one of the things that hasn't changed that I find fairly upsetting, but honestly, if you ask me how I would do it, I don't have a good answer. One of the reasons we had a financial crisis is because the incentive to do short-term things that hurt the rest of us over the long term were huge. That's how the incentives were aligned. And to change that, the society, the regulatory apparatus, et cetera, has to realign the incentives. So that the Wall Street, now, in the old days, the incentives were properly aligned because these were not public companies, they were private partnerships. So the partners had their own capital at risk. So a short-term bet that wound up backfiring 3 years later, you know, would hurt the partner's own pocketbook. So that was appropriate incentives. We don't have that today. They're public partnerships, they're playing with the shareholders' money, they're not playing with their own money. And until we can figure out how to properly realign compensation incentives, we're going to have this problem. And you can decry Wall Street all you want, but that's really not kind of the way to come at it to solve the problem.
And let's not forget when Bear Stearns plummeted, when Lehman Brothers plummeted, those people who own that stock lost those fortunes. I agree with you, Joe. I don't think that this should be a government role, setting compensation. I mean, for me, America has always been a place that I believe you could start from nothing, work really hard, maybe get a little luck, and achieve great success. And I'd like to believe that still remains in this country. Now, having said that, the numbers are mind-boggling. So whose role is it to tell Wall Street how to pay themselves?
You're right about Lehman and Bear, but then you have Stan O'Neill, who walks away with $160 million after...
Absolutely outrageous.
You know, clearly...
They should be pay for performance. So, I don't understand the Stan O'Neill story whatsoever. I don't understand how the board... I mean, we have a structure in place where the board and management teams are supposed to be held accountable. Where was the board to allow the Stan O'Neill to walk out with all of that money after having taken the firm down and shareholders lost money? I don't know. I think we need more accountability on the board and management team. I prefer it not be...
Maria, it's fair to say that a lot of that was deferred compensation that had already been awarded to him for prior service and for which they had no right to take it back.
So I want to throw in an observation here about the law, because one of the great images in law school is the bad man of the law. This is Oliver Wendell Holmes' view about the way the law worked. You never assume, you don't have to assume that people will be virtuous in order for the law to work. You can assume that people will be horrible, avaricious, nasty, greedy, selfish, but if legal structures are put in place with sufficient incentives and sufficient punishments, then people will conform their behavior, because even the bad man doesn't want to be punished and wants to be rewarded. So why not have a system in place like the New Deal system, which didn't assume that people would be good, but put hard and fast divisions between investment banking and commercial banking, which tried to separate different functions, which made it much more easy for the owners of corporations to see what the executives and officers were doing. Why not write into law hard and fast compensation provisions that may not regulate the amount, but regulate the nature of compensation? I know we've done some of that through regulation, but why not have that as a sort of an industry standard, that if you work in a bank, then your compensation is set in a way that over certain years you get money, but it can be clawed back. For exactly the reason that Roy mentioned, you couldn't get back Stan O'Neill's money, but maybe we should be able to get that money back in the future.
But
why not have something?
Dodd-Frank
like
did just what you're saying.
Okay.
They did it.
Is it going to work?
Yeah, that'll work. I mean, I don't think there's a lot of pushback from the banks as to this business of how they get paid and so on. The fact is, the bankers do not want to blow up their own banks. They don't really benefit from that. You may say they don't take the full degree of harm from it that maybe you think they should. You know, they aren't emasculated and flayed and dragged through the streets, but they lost a lot of money, lost their jobs, they lost their pride, all that. They didn't want to do that. Okay. They blew it up by mistake.
Stan O'Neill lost his pride, but he got $100 million.
Out of deferred compensation.
That.
But, you know...
But wait,
well,
Roy,
but he was there his whole life. He did things that they rewarded
him for. Yeah,
Roy
made a point that was accumulated over... How long? I mean, I don't know that the $100 million was accumulated over 40 years, though. I mean, wasn't part of the award for the last, like, couple of years or something?
He had a contract, which enabled him to, the severance was in it. I mean, I don't know the details of it, but he didn't get paid a bonus. He didn't get paid anything discretionary. He was paid only what he was entitled to under contract. And therefore, it's kind of a waste of energy to get mad at the board because they paid him so much. They paid him what they were required to pay him. And they had paid him that much in order to, because that's how much you pay CEOs.
But they also paid him very large bonuses for years like 2006 and 2007 when he was obviously making, doing things that turned out to be have horrible, horrible consequences.
That's true.
Somebody's got to be accountable.
That's true.
Well, what you're saying, though, is treat the banks like utilities. That's what you're saying. I mean, that would change a lot, most notably change the number of people going to Wall Street.
Yes.
For a reason to
It hasn't
get
done
rich.
So. We are still selling a lot of our students to Wall Street. They are still here buying them. We haven't seen anybody say, no, I don't want to work for Goldman Sachs because they're scum. That hasn't happened yet.
Okay.
Give it time.
Give it time.
Well, maybe. They would like to go to hedge funds.
That's something we should talk about if we have time this morning as well, hedge funds. Is there another question over on this side?
Two guys there.
Let's see. This up lady. In front here, actually.
Brett Davenport at 2L. I've got a question just building off the compensation issue and bonuses. So I agree with Professor McKenzie's sort of love of the law, but I think that these managers of funds are sort of a lot more innovative, and they're always going to come up with new solutions to the regulations. And sort of, if you can change their compensation structure so that it's not just the end of the year bonus, and they have a longer term interest, and then secondly, whether that means they're going to go to foreign banks internationally, and we're going to lose a lot of the best managers, or what that dynamic is like.
Well, I think the Dodd-Frank provisions, which were really worked on the arrangements the Fed and the Treasury had worked out with the G20 and all this stuff, but it really was in consultation with the banks, essentially said that senior people have to have about 60% of their payment in stock, and it's paid out over, vests over a five-year period and that sort of thing. And it can be clawed back if there are problems that come from the bonus awards that you received. And in some firms, they're starting to pay people on the basis of the profits of the whole firm rather than their particular area they work in, so they get more cooperative. I don't think that there are very many people in the industry complaining about this. There were, except for one thing. If you go to work at Merrill Lynch, you now get paid in deferred compensation in Bank of America stock. And they may think Bank of America stock isn't very likely to do well. So they think they're getting paid in dross rather than in real money. And so that may encourage them, if they get an offer, to go somewhere else. But if you look around among the top 10 banks, they're all trading at low levels now. None of them are really offering anything, any great stuff. So really, just as the risk is being moved out of the highly regulated sectors into hedge funds and private equity and so on, into the so-called shadow banking, which can fail, by the way, because it isn't too big and it doesn't kill the whole country to have it happen, that's where a lot of the compensation movement is going also. If you think the banks get paid a lot, how do you think John Paulson's doing?
Pretty well.
So you don't think that's a signal to people?
And his tax rate is lower than mine, actually.
He pays capital gains on everything he gets.
And yet, I don't have any problem with John Paulson making $5 billion a year.
Neither do I.
Oh, neither do I.
It's just a contract that he has with his investors, and they can, if they want to pay him five and 50, if
they, huge fees.
If they want to pay him those fees, that's their right. The thing about hedge funds is they didn't bring the system down. When hedge funds failed, they failed. The world went on.
Long-term capital.
One of the great interesting things that happened is that in the wake of long-term capital management, which was a hedge fund that failed, that actually almost did bring the system down in the late 90s, banks really tightened up on hedge funds on the way they sort of overlooked them, and hedge funds became not the problem. And hedge funds remain not the problem. The problem really wound up being the large systemic institutions that nobody quite realized were as dangerous as they were.
There's one question over on this side as well, right here.
Hi, my name is Shengmei Hu. I'm from Wagner School of Public Service. As the name of Dodd-Frank Act suggests, we may be expect some changes in Wall Street. So I wonder if you have perceived at all any changes in Wall Street in terms of business model, innovation, and strategies, if not yet, do you expect to see any changes in the near future? Because I would agree the bubble is always there, sometimes lurking somewhere. So we are surely in for another financial crisis sooner or later. But my hope is that we can, both the regulators as well as, and the financial institutions themselves can do their best to at least postpone the next crisis.
So the question is the new regulatory regime, we talked a little bit about compensation, is it having an effect on business model or other aspects of behavior on Wall Street?
Some. Last year the trading volumes were down about 30% across the board of the top 10 banks. That was because they chose to put them there, not because they were forced to. Several of the banks, the ones that had the most trouble, are the ones doing the most restructuring. Citigroup is going to break itself up into two companies, one called Citicorp, and another called City Holdings, which will be sold off. City Corp will basically be the kind of bank it was when it was originally bought by Travelers in 1998. So that's what its name was then. It's going to revert to being what it was, you know, 12 years ago. Bank of America is in a big mess, and it's got so many companies it's tried to acquire recently, Merrill Lynch, Countrywide, and so on. It'll probably have to chop them up and get rid of some of them because it's unmanageable under the present time. They're losing a lot of people, and they have a lot of other difficulties, but they don't know what all the rules are yet, so they're not quite so sure how to do it. Morgan Stanley has decided to make a very big bet on retail brokerage, which was not a big part of its business before, by buying up into a joint venture with Smith Barney, the old Citigroup part that sold off. So Morgan Stanley's future will be very heavily dependent on retail brokerage, which is much less risky than the kind of proprietary trading, market-making, institutional business they were doing before. UBS is probably going to rethink whether it wants to continue to own Payne Webber after its experiences here. There are some questions about some of the other big players as well. J.P. Morgan, Goldman Sachs, Deutsche Bank probably are going to stay kind of the way they are, hoping to thin out, they'll lose weight in some areas. They may spin off the private equity and hedge funds, which they have to do it by a certain point. So there's a lot of this stuff going on. One big one to watch is whether in the U.K. a commission called the Vickers Commission is going to require that the Glass-Steagall Act be reimposed in Britain, which would be to say some kind of severance between retail and wholesale banking in the UK. If it happens there, it happens for everybody in the banking business operating there, including the American bank. So that would be awkward. You may have to just move your bank to some other country or break it up or whatever. They're not going to know until June what that report is, but they are seriously looking at breaking it up. So the answer is, without knowing what all the Dodd-Frank 250 rules that I mentioned have to be written yet, and not knowing exactly how Volcker rule is going to play out, there is expected to be a lot of restructuring, and some of it's already started. But they really want to see what the real rules are before they pull the plug on major parts of their business being changed.
We have time for one last quick question. In the back there, the gentleman in the black shirt.
There you go. Ms. Bartiromo, in your opening remarks...
Who are you?
Oh, I'm Niril Shah. I'm a 1L. You mentioned that one of the reasons why companies are keeping so much cash on their balance sheets and they're slow to hire is this fear, this regulatory uncertainty. And that's something that I hear a lot. It's pretty commonly repeated and maybe even sincerely believed in the business community. But from my perspective, I have difficulty seeing how something like the Dodd-Frank Act, which is probably the biggest piece of regulatory change coming to the business world, and you know, it doesn't really have anywhere near the same level of bite that Glass-Steagall would have. It's hard for me to see how something that affects the margins of banking activity, activities like prop trading, filters through into the entire business community to such an extent that that's the reason they're incapable of hiring, especially in comparison to big macroeconomic uncertainties like the one we're here discussing today. So to what extent do you believe that there's cause for regulatory uncertainty, and to what extent do you think that's actually the reason why hiring is slow to happen, investment is slow to happen?
A couple of things. I think, first of all, as we sit here, we're waiting for clarity on Dodd-Frank and Basel III. On capital, for example, all of the major banks have put their capital program forward. They are going to hear from regulators in March to see what capital levels are appropriate. And so that's one of the reasons that these guys are sitting on their hands and they're not going to pay a dividend, because the Federal Reserve won't allow them to use that cash for anything more than reserves right now and keeping capital on their balance sheet. So we've got an open question on capital in the face of Dodd-Frank as well as Basel III. You've got an open question on things like prop trading. You know, I throw out one example. You know, the reason that Roy said earlier it's hard to define is because it is. So let's say I am J.P. Morgan, and you come to me as Procter & Gamble, and you say we've got a certain amount of stock that we want to unload, or whoever you are, a big investor. Let's say you've got 5 million shares of IBM just to sell. So you come to me as J.P. Morgan and you say, look, I need to unload this 5 million shares of IBM. What am I going to do? This is my business. I've got to be on the other side of that trade for you. You're my customer. So I buy that 5 million share block. Am I going to dump 5 million shares on the market that day? Of course not. First of all, that's going to move the stock substantially, all that stock on the market. And second of all, I'm in the business of doing a transaction. So I want to try and make money on that as well. So what am I going to do? I'm going to take that share of stock from you. I'm going to sit on it. And I'm going to unload it when I see fit. So let's say I unload that 5 million share block over a two-week period, maybe a week period. In a week, is that proprietary trading? Or is that acting on the other side of a customer's trade?
Well, I guess narrowly my question, though, would be that, you know, how do you see this thing that these regulations that affect a segment of banking that might, you know, increase the cost of capital by 1% or something, how do you see that affecting the entire business community, the non-bank world?
It's the lack of clarity. So I don't know what the rule is right now. I mean, we've gotten more clarity last week because Dodd-Frank is saying it's 3% and they're going to monitor. You can't sit on stock, you can't sit on a position for a certain amount of days. So the point is these companies are saying that they're unable to really understand how their business is going to get impacted, whether it's proprietary trading, whether it's capital levels, whether it's this new consumer protection agency where they won't be able to charge certain fees in some areas of the business. So now they're saying, okay, if I'm not going to get money from overdraft checks, then I'm going to charge people for using an ATM machine. I'm going to charge people for using this because that revenue just went away. So while these laws take effect and while we get more clarity on what really Basel III capital requirements will mean, I'm not going to add heads to the payroll. And let's not forget, in the coming years, I'm going to pay much more for healthcare. So if I'm going to hire new people, I've got to also think not only of the cash portion of their salary, but of their benefits. So how much is that going to cost me? And as a result, they're saying, I'm not going to expend this kind of money on hiring a substantial. No, some companies are hiring. It's not everybody. But for the most part, I still hear from executives that that they are unwilling to add heads to the payroll because of in the face of all these issues. I only threw out the proprietary trading example to give you a sense of what people are saying is still unclear to them and how much it is going to cost them. I don't think we have all the answers right now as we sit here in terms of how this new law plays out.
And we're out of time. I'd like to thank our panelists, and thank you.